In René Descartes' 1637 Discourse on the Method, he wrote, "If there were machines which bore a resemblance to our body and imitated our actions as far as it was morally possible to do so, we should always have two very certain tests by which to recognize that, for all that, they were not real men. The first is that they could never use speech or other signs as we do when placing our thoughts on record for the benefit of others. And the second difference is that although machines can perform certain things as well as or perhaps better than any of us can do, they infallibly fall short in others, by which means we may discover that they did not act from knowledge, but only for the disposition of their organs." In 1950, Alan Turing proposed the idea of building machines that could be linguistically indistinguishable from humans. He suggested a test called the Turing test, in which a computer and a person are hidden from a judge, who then tries to identify which is which by asking questions. Passing this test means that the computer is linguistically indistinguishable from a human. In 1997, the IBM supercomputer Deep Blue defeated world chess champion Garry Kasparov, and in 2016, Google's AlphaGo defeated Lee Sedol in Go. However, AlphaGo still does not understand the rules of Go, and neither does IBM Watson, who beat the world champions of Jeopardy, a game grounded in natural language, in 2011. AI has deep roots in philosophy, and computer science grew out of logic, which is intertwined with philosophy. The origins of AI are older than Descartes, dating back to Aristotle's planning algorithm and his theory of the syllogism. While the advent of high-speed digital computers played a role in the birth of modern AI, the search for answers about reasoning and beliefs long predates the arrival of computers. Some philosophers, such as Daniel Dennett, have gone so far as to claim that AI is simply philosophy, for it is the attempt to capture cognition with algorithms, just as epistemology is the attempt to capture knowledge. However, this view is flawed. AI is an attempt to substantiate the thesis that intelligence is at bottom computational, and this doesn't make AI philosophy any more than the idea that the physical universe can be modeled digitally makes physics philosophy. So what is AI? Well, AI is about creating intelligent agents that act rationally, and this involves collecting information from the environment and taking actions based on that information. Nevertheless, some philosophers wonder if this definition is sufficient to create an artificial person rather than merely an artificial animal. The classical approach to AI is called logicist AI, which, as the name suggests, is based on formal logic. However, common sense reasoning is very different than classical deductive logic, for the latter is monotonic, while the former is not, which means that new information can cause previous inferences to fail. For example, if I tell you that Tweety is a bird, you will infer that Tweety can fly. But then if I tell you that Tweety is a penguin, the inference evaporates. The challenge of logicist AI is to design formalisms that can capture the mechanisms underlying these kinds of cases. The techniques of logic-based AI have reached a level of impressive maturity. In various academic and corporate laboratories, implementations of these formalisms can be used to engineer robust, real-world software that is capable of perceiving and interacting with the external world. Yet, one might be inclined to reject that logic alone can capture all aspects of animal behavior, such as the reflexes required for a hawk to capture its prey, or an athlete in making quick decisions in a game. Despite this, there have been successful projects where logic is used to specify finite-state mechanisms for robot control, such as catching a ball in flight. Regardless, there are other ways to build AI, which fall under the category of non-logicist AI. The formalisms used by these agents cannot represent knowledge in the normal sense, as they cannot use declarative statements. That is to say, for human reasoning, if the sky is blue is true, then the sky is blue is a declarative sentence. Knowledge is obviously important to intelligence, but non-logicist AI is very good at capturing other aspects of intelligence, which rely on statistical learning and pattern recognition. There are two main types of non-logicist AI. The symbolic approach uses formalisms based on probabilities, and the neurocomputational approach uses artificial neural networks, which attempt to model the behavior of neurons in the brain. While neural networks in theory have an efficient learning algorithm, they were previously difficult to train, particularly those that are multi-layered and thus expressive enough to represent non-linear functions. This all changed in the mid-2000s, with the development of methods that made proper use of advanced hardware. One of the key observations in recent years is that deep neural networks can be pre-trained in an unsupervised phase, where they are fed data without any labels. Each layer learns to represent the outputs of the layer below it, resulting in a series of layers that represent the input domain with increasing levels of abstraction. For example, if we pre-train a network with images of faces, we would get a first layer that detects edges, a second layer that can combine edges to form facial features such as eyes, noses, etc., and a third layer that responds to groups of those features. OpenAI's GPTs, or Generative Pre-trained Transformers, utilize such an unsupervised pre-training phase where models are fed a large amount of unlabeled text data. As the GPT learns to understand the structure and patterns in the data, it learns to generate text by predicting what words are likely to come next in a given sentence or context. However, learning complex concepts is still rather difficult. For instance, consider computer vision, where an agent needs to form intermediate concepts like desk and tray without explicit human supervision. Yet, AI has made significant progress with deep learning and representation in recent years, with the development of advanced language models like GPT-3 and GPT-4. These models have demonstrated impressive capabilities in generating human-like text and performing a range of natural language processing tasks. These developments have addressed some of the challenges in learning by reading that were previously faced by AI. While formal models of learning in AI may not always be directly applicable to learning by reading, the advanced language models like GPT-3 and GPT-4 have shown that AI can now generate text that appears to be written by humans in response to a given prompt, and can even perform tasks like summarization based on reading comprehension. Reading is crucial to intelligence because it is a way to acquire knowledge. But while human readers learn a language alongside reading, language models like GPT-4 process text via complex mathematical algorithms. The question as to whether an artificial agent must truly learn a natural language to be able to read remains to be answered. Today's AI focuses on creating computational artifacts that pass tests, not necessarily on processing information in the way that humans do. Consciousness and creativity are challenges for AI that haven't been fully addressed. Subjective consciousness, which is essential to human life, is largely missing from AI research, cognitive psychology, and computational cognitive modeling. While some may argue that subjective consciousness is a philosophical problem, it's important to note that AI measures itself by looking at the remarkable mental powers found in animals and humans, and the lack of attention given to consciousness is still a major problem. It is a virtual certainty that if human-level AI is possible, it will be engineered by drawing from both logicist and non-logicist paradigms. Indeed, cognitive scientist Ron Sun has been working to demonstrate that human cognition, which appears logical and symbolic on the surface, can arise from cognition that is neurocomputational. At this point, we should acknowledge that there are two fundamentally different classifications of AI, the strong and weak variety. Strong AI aims to create machines that have all the mental powers we have, including consciousness. Weak AI, on the other hand, aims to build machines that simply appear to have the full mental capabilities of humans. It is difficult for philosophers to argue against the possibility of weak AI, as all steps in AI research are steps towards weak AI, but there are many philosophers who have challenged the possibility of strong AI. The most well-known argument in the philosophy of AI is John Searle's Chinese Room argument, which aims to refute strong AI. Searle's argument suggests that even though a computer may be able to convince a human that they understand a language, it does not literally understand it. The argument involves a thought experiment in which Searle is inside a room receiving Chinese questions and producing output based on an English rulebook, even though he doesn't understand Chinese. The argument suggests that since Searle is just blindly following rules without any understanding, so too must be all computers. A different approach in arguing against strong AI relies on Gödel's first incompleteness theorem, which, simply put, states that any sufficiently powerful, consistent formal system, in this case some AI, will contain some true statements that cannot be proved within it. This statement is unprovable, is a simplified example of such true statements. In 1964, J.R. Lucas argued that Gödel's first incompleteness theorem entails that no machine can ever reach human-level intelligence, since the machine can only find provable statements to be true, whereas a human can see this is a mistake. Lucas's argument has not proved to be overly compelling, but Lucas initiated a debate that has produced more formidable arguments. One of Lucas's most indefatigable defenders is the physicist Roger Penrose, whose most fastidious Gödelian argument can be found in chapters 2 and 3 of his Shadows of the Mind from 1994. It goes as follows. A system is sound when its rules and axioms only produce true statements. Now suppose that my reasoning powers are captured by some formal system called F. Insofar as my reasoning powers are sound, F is also sound, and so is F plus the assumption that my reasoning powers are F. We can call this larger system F2. But then, because of Gödel's theorem, I know that there is an unprovable truth in F2, and since it is unprovable, I know that F2 could not produce this truth, and therefore could not see that it is true. However, if my reasoning powers are equal to F2, then F2 must be able to see that the unprovable truth is true, since I can see that it is true. We have therefore reached a contradiction. F2 could not, and must be able to, prove the unprovable statement. We must therefore conclude that our initial assumption must be false. F2, or any formal system whatsoever, cannot capture my reasoning powers. Whether this argument succeeds or not is still a matter of disagreement, but if it does, then the computational theory of mind, on which our hopes for AI are grounded, must be false. Penrose's own perspective is that human consciousness depends on quantum mechanical processes within neurons and is therefore non-computable. The original objection to Lucas's argument was that the mind avoids Gödel's theorem because it is inconsistent, and similar objections have been raised against Penrose in regard to the soundness of our reasoning powers. That is to say, not everything human reason believes to be true is actually true, so our reason may not be sound. Both Lucas and Penrose respond to their respective detractors by arguing that there is a difference between the correctable mistakes we make and the unassailable truths we know for sure, and only the latter are important for establishing the soundness of the mind. Regardless of these issues, predicting the future of science and technology generally is a difficult task, and this is especially true for AI. In the 1950s, Herb Simon predicted that thinking machines were just around the corner, and in the 1980s, Hans Moravec predicted that robots would surpass humans in all areas by the mid-2030s. Recent discussions have focused on something called the singularity, which is the point at which machines become smarter than humans, rapidly increasing their intelligence until they reach superintelligence. Whether such superintelligent machines will be moral is another important question, and some experts believe that this could lead to a dangerous future as powerful technologies become available to individuals and small groups. Extreme evil could be perfected by intelligent machines, and some philosophers like Bill Joy argue that this could lead to a small elite controlling the machines and viewing humans as unnecessary. Others, like Nick Bostrom, worry that the first superintelligence could even lead to the extinction of humanity. Not all philosophers are so pessimistic, however. John Searle argues that these concerns are entirely unfounded, for machines cannot be conscious and therefore cannot be malicious. However, most AI engineers build machines without concern for consciousness, and an autonomous machine with overwhelming destructive power could still cause harm without genuine human-level desires. The ethics of artificial intelligence is a large topic in itself, and the discussion is better suited for a video of its own. Nevertheless, one thing we can be sure of is that, in the future, AI will create artificial animals that will be trained to do jobs for humans. It's also possible that humans will become more like cyborgs with the help of artificial limbs, sense organs, and implants. This could help us use less intelligent machines more easily. Of course, the big question is whether AI will create machines that are smarter than humans, and this question is not just for scientists and engineers, but also for philosophers. If the arguments against strong AI are sound, then it's unlikely that machines will ever have mental powers equal to humans. This, of course, does nothing to reduce the fact that machines will have, and arguably already have, certain capabilities that far exceed the weaker mental powers of humans. And that's about all for this video. Thank you for your time and attention. If you'd like to learn more about this topic, a video discussing the ethics of artificial intelligence will be linked in the description below. And if you'd like to watch a deeper dive into the Chinese room argument, the relationship between Gödel's incompleteness theorems and the mind, or anything else, please let me know in the comments. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel, and feel free to buy me a coffee if you think I deserve it. Thanks again, and have a great rest of your day.